Wow. All right. that was a song when, like, I was in high school. All right. So every time I'm like, what are we doing? That's crazy. Hey, good to see you all this morning. My name is Dave. As Jeff said, I'm one of the pastors here at Harvest. And just really, I feel my heart is full to be with you this morning. Every song we're singing, I'm like, that's enough. That's enough. Just concentrate on that. Go home. It's going to be a good week. And I'm like, well, I guess we're going to have a message too. But it's just good to be able to worship together today. We are in the middle of a series about prayer. Our hope, our desire, our intent is that through this, God will use his word to stir me up, to stir you up, to stir us up to actually pray. It's good to talk about prayer. It's better to actually pray. Okay, so that's where we're going with this. I got to tell you a funny story. So a couple weeks ago, we gave away these stickers. Anybody get a sticker? Raise your hand if you got a sticker. Wow. Well, they're out there, guys, somewhere. Unless Jeff's keeping them to himself. Are you keeping them yourself? They're out there. Okay. So I put this on my phone just to remind me to pray, right? And so I'm at my group with my guys, my discipleship group, all guys from the church. It's been like 3 weeks of the sermon series, and my phone is sitting on the table. And one of the guys, about a half hour in, he goes, Dave, I got to just ask, what's with the sticker? Okay, well, like, we're 3 weeks into the sermon series, right? And he's from our church, and yeah. So I was not real sure what to say at the moment. The other two guys took their spot. They're like, dude, what is your, go to church. Come on, man. So get your sticker, go to church. All right, so we're in this series called A.S.K, which is really an acronym, Ask, Seek, Knock. And that comes right from Matthew 7:7. We had a sermon on that. We had two sermons from the Lord's Prayer, which is instructive to us to learn how we ought to pray. Last week, we were in Philippians 4:6-7 about being anxious. What do you do when you're dealing with anxiety? You go to the Lord in prayer. You let your petitions be known to him, and he offers peace that surpasses all understanding. So today, we're continuing in this series on Ask, and the title today is this, A Desperate Prayer. A Desperate Prayer. This sermon, I'm just disclaimer right up front, this is one of those sermons that's like, hang on to this, you know, those fire extinguishers. In case of emergency, break glass open, you're going to need this. I'm just going to tell you right up front, not everyone today is going to be like, that's where I am today. You might not feel desperate today, but hang on to this. Because it's likely there will be a time when you need a message like today. Now, I also believe, with enough people in this room, this is for some of us today. I feel desperate. I'm facing something that is intense. It's overwhelming. It's big, bigger than me, for sure. It's scary. It's threatening. It's uncertain. I was talking with another one of our pastors. I went with Jeff to Guatemala this week, and it was tremendous. We're going to tell you a lot about it a little bit today and a lot more in the future. But we were talking as pastors about, like, man, we get the craziest stuff on our phone. Like, I promise. Like, the texts, the emails, the phone calls, and you just don't really know what the next message is going to be. And just this week, I heard about a friend of mine who now lives out of state, and through an accident, they were having a memorial service, funeral service for his son, 17 years old. I was like, Lord, help them. And I get the cancer updates and the treatments and the marriage challenge and the financial crisis. And that's an honor, guys. I'm not saying that as a woe is me. That's an honor. But sometimes it is a desperate place. We're going to look at a passage today that helps us when it feels like this. I don't have an answer for this. You ever feel like that? I do not have an answer for this. This is a crisis. This is heavy. This is overwhelming to me. Today we're going to look at a passage in just a moment, but before we do that, I want to invite you to pray with me. Let's all pray. Lord, we've got a little time set aside here, and what is most important is that we would hear from you. I pray that you would just use the words spoken, mostly your word, Lord, to remind us of who you are, to point our hearts to you in the middle of whatever circumstance. Maybe it's the general concerns of life, the anxieties we live with, but maybe Maybe, Lord, it's at the point of crisis. Maybe today, maybe in the day to come, but we're looking to you and we're asking you to teach us. Lord, please teach us of who you are today. We need you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen, amen. All right, we're going to be looking in the book of 2 Chronicles. You're like, what? Yeah, 2 Chronicles, Old Testament. It's the, if you're not real familiar with the Bible, it's actually the 14th book of the Bible. It's just kind of count or something as you go. It's about a third of the way in if you're doing it that way. 2 Chronicles. This is a period of history where there was what's called a divided kingdom. So Israel was one group of tribes, but then there was a season, a period of time where the kingdom was divided. There was a northern kingdom called Israel, and then there was a kingdom of Judah in the south. Judah was smaller. However, it had the city of Jerusalem. Now, there were kings, both of the northern kingdom, Israel, and kings of Judah, a king of Judah in the southern kingdom. And today we're going to read about a king whose name is, fun name, you ready? You want to guess? You already know. You don't know. Maybe you know. I'll tell you. It's Jehoshaphat or Jehoshaphat. You pick. So 2 Chronicles 20, we're going to read a story about King Jehoshaphat. Now, here's the thing. This is going to tell us a story about a very specific, dangerous, overwhelming reality that he and the people of Judah were facing. This is historical for sure, and it is instructive, okay? I'm not saying you're King Jehoshaphat, but I'm saying you can learn from him, and I can learn from him today. So we're going to get into it here in a second, but I want to give you the first point. If you're taking notes, or do you take notes? You should take notes. It's not about me. It's about you. You want to remember this stuff, okay? So if you're going to take notes, first point is this. When you're afraid, seek the Lord. When you're afraid, seek the Lord. Now we're going to walk through this and look at the verses. Let's put up the first verse from 2 Chronicles 20. After this, the Moabites and the Ammonites, and with them some of the Meunites, came against Jehoshaphat for battle. Okay, here's what you need to know about this. Jehoshaphat's a king, right? He's responsible for the kingdom of Judah. What is happening is three different enemy groups of people decided they have something in common. We don't like Judah. We don't like Jehoshaphat. And so they're pooling their resources, they're gathering together, and they're coming. Okay, that, like, sometimes you read something, you're like, oh, that's interesting. No, that's not interesting. That's terrifying. You're the king of Judah. Three different people groups are, our best effort is to come and take you out. You're going to be gone. Your family's going to be gone. The kingdom's going to be gone. Good morning, Jehoshaphat. Okay? Now, here's the second verse. It says this. It doesn't say that. It says this. Some men came and told Jehoshaphat, a great multitude is coming against you from Edom, from beyond the sea, and behold, they are in Hazazon Tamar. That is En-Gedi. You guys are like, you're killing me with all this geography. Hey, this is the reason I say this is historical. It's real. You can track those places. You can see where this is. So what's happening here is Jehoshaphat gets a message. There is not just three groups of people coming against you. They're described how? They're described as a great multitude, all right? They're from beyond the sea. This is a reference to the Dead Sea. These three people groups were on the east side of the Dead Sea, Jerusalem and Judah on the west side of the Dead Sea, and they were coming. Now, if Jehoshaphat could have read his text, it might have said this, a bunch of bad guys coming for you to kill you and your people, they'll be there soon. That's basically what this is telling him. Okay, the fact that they were in En-Gedi means they're on the move. It means they're 25, 30, maybe 35 miles max from where Jehoshaphat is. This is not an idea. This is not a concept. This is not a speech. This is a gathered group of enemies, and they're coming your way. Okay, that sounds desperate. Verse 3 says this, then Jehoshaphat was afraid. Now that makes so much sense to me. Does that not make sense to you? You be the king of Judah. What are you feeling? Terrified. Are you kidding me? Three different armies coming together on the move, getting close, maybe today, maybe tomorrow. Of course you'd be afraid. You're crazy if you're not afraid, right? He was afraid. Jehoshaphat, this will not end well. There's really no way out. This could be the end. You need to feel the weight of that, because that's exactly what Jehoshaphat would have felt. Now, he made a choice, and you can see it right there in verse 3. He was afraid and did what? He set his face to seek the Lord. We're going to dwell on that a bit today, but he set his face to seek the Lord, and he proclaimed a fast throughout all of Judah. Verse 4 says, and Judah, this is all the people, assembled to seek help from the Lord. From all the cities of Judah, they came to seek the Lord. All right, enemies are coming. They're on the way. Jehoshaphat's responsible, and he is afraid. What did he do? He sought the Lord. He said, people, we need to pray. We need to fast. The people said, let's gather. When you're afraid is the time to seek the Lord. There's so many things in Scripture that point to this. And again, if you're taking notes, please write some of these verses down. I don't think my words matter, but God's words matter so much. And I want to give you a couple verses that remind us about who he is and what he does. Psalm 121, verses 1 and 2 says, I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. Loved ones, it doesn't matter if you've got a small concern, a big concern, or you're in a place of desperation today. Where do we look for help? Well, I'm pretty smart. I look there. I've got good friends and connections. I look there. I've got a pretty good bank account. I go there. No. My help comes from the Lord. Whatever thing that is uncertain, whatever point that is concerning, whatever thing is too big for you, our help comes from the Lord. We lift our eyes to the Lord. Does the Lord have a resume? Lord, could you just provide a little resume? Do you have any experience in this? Yeah, well, I made heaven and earth. All right, well, that's helpful. That's instructive. Yeah, he's the God of everything. That is the God who says, I'm available to you. Proverbs 18:10 says, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous man runs into it and is safe. I don't know, Lord. This thing is, it's too much. I can't solve this. I don't think there's a way that I can get out. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and are what? They're safe. They're safe. So in the midst of desperation, we look to the Lord. I got a question for you. Have you ever chosen to seek the Lord? I mean, you're at church. That's pretty good stuff. Good job, everybody. But I'm not talking about church attendance. I'm talking about where do you go for purpose, for help, for salvation? Have you ever realized I am desperate for the Lord? The gospel tells us that we are sinful people, that our sins separate us from a holy God. And because of that, I won't be in his presence because of my wickedness, my sin. And yet, Jesus is a gift of God who lived a perfect, sinless life, who gave his life for us so that we could have a Savior. We could have a hope. We could have a future. We could have identity in Christ now and presence with him in eternity. And my question to you is this. Have you sought the Lord? Because he is a strong tower. Because he is a refuge. Because he is our help. Have you ever sought him? But I want to ask you this too. Have you ever sought him in desperation? It's kind of an amazing thing how God will bring us to the end of ourself to show us how great he actually is. You think you got it figured out? Wait till you don't. Then what? Our God is our hope. Our God is our help. Have you ever sought him in desperation? We've referenced this trip to Guatemala a couple of times. On Wednesday of this week, we were in a church and we met with a bunch of people, and then we got to go visit some homes. And I got to go with a couple of people, Grupo Uno, that's who I was in, that's group number one. You guys awake? All right. So, thanks for clapping. All right. This is the woman on the left there is Alicia, and she's holding Jorge, and that's their home. They were super gracious to have us come in, to have us visit, and as I heard her tell her story, it went a little like this, that she was married, and then she was pregnant, and then her husband wasn't there anymore. He was going to be somewhere else, and so she's on her own with a little boy. Now, that's a big deal anywhere in the world, but in that region, with the economic challenges and the cultural realities, she's alone, she's pregnant, now she's got a little boy. That is unsafe, that is uncertain, that is vulnerable, that is desperate. And she got to know the local church that had a program for moms and babies who came around her, and Alicia, in her desperation, came to a place of understanding that Jesus Christ is her hope, and Jesus Christ is her Savior, and she trusts Him, as Jeff said, as her Savior. Sometimes that desperate place is the place where God's like, let me show you who I actually am. Let me show you how I actually operate and how I love you and how you are okay when you put your hope in me. You will be okay. That was an amazing thing to watch. So we need to seek the Lord when we are fearful. You know, this theme of seeking the Lord, seeking His face, it's all through the book of 2 Chronicles. I've got six different references. I'm not going to go through them all, but time and time and time again, you hear that the people set their face, the people set their heart to seek His face, the people set their attention on the Lord. And what I take away from that, guys, is that is so intentional. There are so very many things that want to pull our attention away. Is this true for you? Oh my goodness. There's everywhere you turn, there's another thing that can distract us from having our full attention on our God. And there's this intentionality. You see it in Jehoshaphat, and you see it throughout 2 Chronicles. They set their face to seek the Lord. It happened with King Asa. It happened with Hezekiah. It happened with Josiah. So specifically, how do we seek the Lord? Well, Jehoshaphat, here's what he did. He proclaimed a fast throughout all Judah. We are in trouble. We need the Lord. Stop eating. Pray. I mean, that's the short version of it. But he commanded them to fast. He said, we're not just going to pray. We're going to fast because it reminds us that our desperation can only be met in our God. He is our provider. Now, Scripture as a whole does not command us to fast. It's not like, thou shalt fast. But what it does do is it holds up fasting as a way to focus your prayer. I will forego food for a period of time. I will forego media. I'll forego whatever. The reason is I so desperately need the Lord that I will remind myself of that by allowing myself to be a little hungry, to be a little tired, to be a little... And God, throughout His Word, shows that prayer and fasting increase our focus upon Him, and it increases the impact and power of our prayer, and it reminds us that our help comes from the Lord. So Jeff announced this morning, we're going to fast at the cathedral the rest of October. No, I'm just teasing. Sometimes you do this in a planned way like that, but I would encourage you to think, I do really need the Lord. And I am wanting to draw near to Him. And maybe the thing that would stir that up for you is to say, I'm going to forego this food, this media, this plan for a period of time because I want my attention to be completely on Him. That's what Jehoshaphat and the people of Judah chose to do. They called out to Him together, they're fasting and praying. When you're afraid, you need to seek the Lord. okay? When you're afraid, you need to seek the Lord. Now, I just have to ask you a question. Do you have anything you're afraid of today? I'm not really looking for you to answer. Just think about it for a second, all right? Do you have anything you're afraid of today? Something where the threat is near, it's big, it's uncertain, it's overwhelming. Categories I hear this in for people is health. You know, the diagnosis is not good. The plan is uncertain. It's ominous. Maybe that's personal to you. Maybe that's for someone you love. Another category, relationships, can feel desperate. It's broken. It's painful. Too much water under the bridge. Too much hurt. Too much history. It's not working. It's very painful. Do you have points of fear in any of that? Finances. Do you know what it costs to go to college in this area? Do you know what it costs to buy a car, to buy a house, to pay for the things? I feel stuck. I feel overcommitted. This is a grim reality. I'm scheduled to get out of debt in like 50 years, maybe. I don't want to make light of that. That can be a desperate place. World events? Oh my goodness. Which one you want to pick? I mean, we've got war happening in the Middle East. We've got violence in our city. There's unrest. There's strife. Politics. Ugh. Godlessness all around our world. You're like, I'm so glad I came to church. It's so encouraging. I don't know if any of those things provoke fear, but they might. Sometimes spiritual crisis. Lord, I don't know. I don't know. I want to know, but it's very unclear to me, and I have questions, and I don't understand how these things go together, and how can this be, and I feel more distant from you. Here's the thing, guys. What you do when you're afraid really matters. What you do when you're afraid really matters, okay? Here's some things we tend to do. Here's a category, escape. Yeah, I'm out. Moving to I don't know where, but somewhere where there's perfectly peaceful. Okay, well, that doesn't exist. But I'm out. I'm out of this relationship. I'm not doing this. I quit. I run far and fast. That's a common reaction when we're scared. Or here's another, that'd be the flight thing, right? How about the fight thing? Yeah? Bring it on, Landon. Sorry, I just saw Landon there. Not really. I love Landon, but you know what I'm saying. Like, I'll fight you. You want to fight? Let's fight. You do it out of fear sometimes. Here's another reaction, control. There's so many things I can't control, but you know what I will control? Everything I can. I'm going to make it happen my way so it doesn't, the stuff goes the way I want it, need it. We do this. Or we lose hope. What difference does it make? It's just me. I can't make a difference. I don't know that there's really hope in the midst of all this. It's not going to go well. I'm stuck. Here's what I want to encourage you with, loved ones. 1 Corinthians 10:13 tells us that there's no temptation that has seized you except what is common to man. When you feel fear, when you feel despair, when you feel stuck, God is faithful. And that verse ends by saying, and with the temptation, he will provide a way of escape. You're like, now we're talking, escape. Jehoshaphat's like, yeah, escape. Can I tell you that what I see in Scripture and what I see in life is that the way of escape is the way through with God leading you. So many times what I want is to get out of that situation. I'm done. I'm out. And I see that the Lord gives you the grace and the strength and the leadership and the provision to continue in his strength, and that the way out of the challenge is through. So maybe that's for somebody today when you feel like, I don't know. When you're afraid, you seek the Lord. Jehoshaphat did this. He set his face to seek the Lord. Can I just say for Jehoshaphat, this wasn't the first time he did that. It was not the first time he did that. And one of the things that can help us, loved ones, is to make a decision to seek the Lord when the sun is out. It is a beautiful day in the city today. Decide today where you will run in crisis. I will run to the Lord. I will run to my church family. I will run to his word because that is where my hope comes from. Jehoshaphat set his face to seek the Lord. He called a fast, and the people came, and they prayed. And they prayed humbly, and they prayed honestly. When you're afraid, seek the Lord. That's the first point. The other ones might be shorter. Here's the second point. When you're overwhelmed, remember who God is. When you're overwhelmed, remember who God is. Jehoshaphat, I might say that 10 different ways today. Jay, should we call him Jay? Had a dire problem with no solution. We're toast. These three armies, they're coming, they're close, they hate us. When you're overwhelmed, you need to remember who God is. I'm so thankful that God's word records his prayer. We get to hear what they prayed, and we're going to walk through this. Now, we're on just clarity of where we're at in the sermon. We're on point two. I'm about to give you five things I see in prayer. It's not points one through five. It's five under two. Got it? Y'all are so sharp. All right, five helpful things we see in Jay's prayer. Here's the first thing. Let's pray. I just call it let's pray. I said before, it's so much better to pray than to talk about prayer. Let's pray. Jehoshaphat prayed. Here's verse 5. It says this, Jehoshaphat stood in the assembly of Judah and Jerusalem in the house of the Lord before the new court, the assembled court that had just gathered. Okay, here it is. Let's pray. Jehoshaphat had influence. He had position. And what did he do? He said, we need the Lord. Do we have any kings in the house today? Anybody else? Nope. All right. You still have an opportunity for influence. One of the best things you can do in a marriage when it's hard is to say, why don't we pray about that? One of the best things you can do when you hear a friend going through a hard time is to say, can I pray for you about that? Let's pray, okay? Jehoshaphat knew where his help came from, and he called the people to prayer. There was a common trust, a shared faith. They're going to seek the living God together. I need this. I have had times with Jeff where I've said, Jeff, could you just pray? Because I'm not really quite sure. And he's had times when he'll say, would you just pray? And I will. And we need each other, the body of Christ, to pray. Jehoshaphat called the people to pray. Let's pray. Okay, back to Guatemala. Did we mention we were in Guatemala this week? Okay, we were in Guatemala this week, and it was really instructive and stirring to me a couple of different times. We were with leaders in the churches, and we would say, could we please pray for you? Actually, one of the times they said, we're going to pray, and then they're like, then they said, everybody stand up. And I was like, okay. Like, they were not playing. They're like, if we're going to pray, we're going to pray. Get up and give the Lord your attention. I'm like, okay, yeah, I like that. Then we said, well, can we pray for you? And we kind of gathered around them. And I've got a picture of it, actually. We were there with this dear people. These are the leaders in the church, the leaders of this children's ministry. And we said, can we pray for you? And they all went straight to their knees. It was not choreographed. Nobody told them what to do. I was like, okay, if we're going to pray, we're going to pray. We're going to seek the Lord together. And there's something about the posture of, I will humble myself and get down on my knees, or I will stand up out of respect and honor. And I have goosebumps thinking about it right now because I don't always do that. Yeah, Elvin, I'll pray. I'll pray maybe sometime. But what if we were to call each other to prayer? We need to seek the Lord, and we're not playing. The other thing they would do, one person would start praying, like leading the prayer, and they all just prayed. I was like, what is happening right now? Well, they were all seeking the living God together. That stirs me. Let's pray. When you're overwhelmed, remember who God is. So first of 5 points, let's pray. Secondly, here's the second thing. You are God. You are God. Verse 6 says this, And they said, O Lord, God of our fathers, are you not God in heaven? You rule over all the kingdoms of the nations. In your hand are power and might, so that none is able to withstand you. So not only do I see that they prayed, but they prayed to the God. He is undefeated. He is unmatched. He is glorious. He is all powerful. And what did they pray? They prayed things that reminded themselves that he's God. I'm not talking to whoever. I'm talking to the living God. Let's pray, you are God. Loved ones, Pastor Jeff, maybe you did, or Pastor Jeff Buckton, we get different messages, different campuses. This idea, we have to hold in tension that God is greater and God is near. Sometimes we put so much emphasis on that he is near that we forget that he's the God who made it all. And when you pray in desperation, remind yourself and remind each other, we worship the living God. That's where my help comes from, the maker of heaven and earth. Here's the third thing I see. Not only you are God, but the third is you are our God. You are our God. Look at verse 7. Did you not, our God, drive out the inhabitants of this land before your people Israel and give it forever to the descendants of Abraham, your friend? What's going on here? They're reminding themselves and even saying to the Lord, Lord, you're our God. This is not, you're not distant. You gave this to us. You made promises to us. We are your people. We belong to you and we look to you. So these principles, let's pray, you are God, you are our God. And then verse 8, we are your people. We are your people. Verse 8 says, and they have lived in it, and they have built for you a sanctuary for your name, saying, verse 9, if disaster comes upon us, the sword, judgment, pestilence, or famine, we will stand before this house and before you, for your name is in this house, and cry out to you in our affliction, and you will hear and save. We're praying, you are God, you are our God, but what else? We are your people. We're seeking your face. We are deciding that when we seek you, you're our only hope. We know you, God. We honor you, and we trust in you. Again, I want you to think about this. Do you know him? Well, maybe you could pass the test about him, you know, fill in the right answers, but do you know him? Have you pressed down upon these promises when it is hard, when it is desperate, when it feels too much? Do you know him? Do you know him biblically? Do you know what God's word says? But do you know him historically in church history and biblical history? But do you know him in your own history? One of the things I long for, I know we got a lot of students here today, and my wife and I went to Moody, so hey, thumbs up. But 100 years ago, she was 40 years ago, I was 100. Anyway, I want so much for you to know your God. Yeah, the classes, the theology, all that, but to know him, to know that he's faithful, to know that he's near, to know that he's sovereign, to know that he's good. The way you know those things experientially is you trust him and you lean in when it's hard. When I'm afraid, I trust you. When I'm overwhelmed, I remember who you are. And then there's a fifth thing. The fifth thing is we are in trouble. Here's a little principle of prayer. God, we need to tell you something. We are in trouble. Look at verse 10 and verse 11. And now, behold, this is still Jehoshaphat praying in the assembly. Now, behold, the men of Ammon and Moab and Mount Seir, who you would not let Israel invade when they came from the land of Egypt. Okay, little sidebar here. You go to Deuteronomy 2, verse 5, and there's a little story there about how God was leading Moses to lead the people and to take the land that he promised for them, and he told them, don't mess with those people. Just leave them alone. Don't mess with the Ammonites over by Mount Seir. That's what's going on here. So Jehoshaphat's like, the men of Ammon, Moab, Mount Seir, who you would not let Israel invade, God, remember? They're here because you wanted them to be here. Now they're going to come kill us. That's not cool. When they came from the land of Egypt, and whom they avoided and did not destroy. Verse 11, behold, they reward us. I like the sarcasm of Scripture. They reward us now by coming to drive us out of your possession, which you have given us to inherit. You get what's going on here? They're like, we have a serious problem. And God, part of it kind of, you kind of set it up this way. You told us to leave those people alone, and now look what happened. But here's what I take away from that. You can be honest about your need. God, you could have done this different, but here I am. You're sovereign. Why am I in this space? Why am I facing this? You could have, wouldn't it be better, God, if I never suffered? Wouldn't it be better if I didn't have to go through such a hard thing? Well, apparently not from God's perspective, because he brings about his glory and his purposes even through our suffering. And so they prayed quite honestly, we are in trouble. So, why do bad things happen to God's people? Well, I would just simply say, for God's purposes. We worship and trust and serve a God who is sovereign, and he is good. Those are not disconnected concepts. He is in control, and he is good. His thoughts are higher than our thoughts. His ways are higher than our ways. We are not promised a life of ease. In fact, we are promised that in this world, we will have troubles, Jesus told us. We will not always live in a reality that is what we want, but we can trust our God, who is good. He's in control, and he's working out his purposes. All that I can see right here, right now, from my little time-bound perspective, is difficult, but God is working out his purposes in a perfect and eternal plan. Today, this is the day we live between the promise of heaven that we already have in Christ and the reality of heaven. And in between, we live in a broken world where we will struggle and where God is working out purposes we don't always understand. It made me think of Psalm 62, verse 8. Psalm 62, verse 8 says, trust in him at all times, O people. Pour out your heart before him. God is a refuge for us. Psalm 62, 8, trust in him at all times, O people. Pour out your heart before him. God is a refuge for us. When you're overwhelmed, remember who God is. And the third point is this. When you are powerless, keep your eyes on God. I don't like being powerless. I like to be in control. I like to have a plan. I like to be able to solve the problem. I like to be able to make a decision. When we are powerless, keep your eyes on God. I want to tell you two personal stories. About 3 years, a little over 3 years ago, my wife and I have four daughters, and our second daughter, real athletic, active, was in an accident. It was like one of those utility vehicles, like six-seater things, and it rolled over, and her leg was hurt very badly, broke her leg really badly. We found out about it because they said, hey, she was away on a retreat, and they said, hey, your daughter... accident. Actually, they first said something happened to her leg. I'm like, okay, well, bandage it up. You know, she'll have a good retreat. And they're like, well, actually, it's a little more than that. It's probably broken. Okay. Well, keep us posted. Well, actually, it's the helicopter's coming. They're going to take her to, whoa. What? And they took her to a bigger hospital than the one they first intended because more was needed. And after a couple of days at that hospital, let's go to a bigger hospital because more is needed. And she was in the hospital for like a month and many surgeries. And it was like, Lord, what are you doing? Where are you in the midst of this? And I can tell you, we prayed probably like we'd never prayed before. Lord, meet the need. Lord, heal. Lord, let her keep her foot. Lord, help us to know how to love her. And in the desperation, you can seek the Lord, and he's faithful. I can tell you this, in the midst of it, we had dear friends who were praying. Some of them are in this room. And I have this friend. You ever have a friend who's different than you? Yeah. Oh, I got a bunch of those. But anyway, one of them was, I was like, you know, I want to encourage my daughter. So there was this whole prayer chain website thing where people were praying. And I said, hey, could you take the names of the people who are praying and put them on a piece of paper just so we can have them in the hospital room and like be reminded that people are praying? And he's an artist, my friend. So I was like picturing three columns, Excel spreadsheet, you know. It's not what he did. Let me show you what he did. He put this together for us. This is our, up above there, that's my last name, Learned. And then there were all the people praying. I don't know what would have happened, but God's people prayed. And let me show you a little closer if you can't quite see it. Every bit of that art are people's names. And in the midst of the hardest time, we were being held up in prayer. And up above, you can see he was so thoughtful. He took the names of our family and he put them in the letters up above. And that's exactly what happened. It was a desperate situation, and we were being held up by God's people in prayer. Praise the Lord. Annika's doing fine, by the way. This morning, she's in college in Arizona. She's crazy. She sent a text to mom this morning. By the way, going to go hike Camelback Mountain this morning before church. We're like, you're killing me, and that's awesome. So she's doing really well. I want to tell you another story about a good friend of ours. Some of our closest friends in life have a son. His name is John. John was diagnosed with a tumor. He was 9 years old. This is not operable. This is not treatable. This is not curable. We're just talking about time unless the Lord intervenes. I won't get into all the details, but I can tell you this. John loved Jesus. John walked with Jesus. And John's with Jesus. Now, Lord, what are you doing? Where am I supposed to go in desperation? Where am I supposed to go with all of that? Well, we run to the Lord because our help is from the Lord and our hope is in the Lord. And he's doing something. I promise you this. John was so full of life. He's having a great day today. He's healed in the presence of the Lord. Now, why do I say all this? Because when we talk about prayer, it is not a formula to get to your desired outcomes. It is a formula to walk by faith with our God who is faithful and good. And he's doing something that we cannot always perceive. John, who's nine years old, quoted this to his parents as he was walking through his struggle. Isaiah 41:10, fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. God is faithful, loved ones. You can trust him, and in desperation, we can run to him. When you're afraid, seek the Lord. If it isn't that intense for you today, well, I'm really happy to hear that. But decide today where your help comes from and seek him today and build your resume of his faithfulness, because there's probably a day in the future when you're going to need to know where to go. And you need to run to the living God. He does not promise us short-term outcomes that are what we always desire, but he promises to be faithful to his character and his purposes and his people. God will do what is best from his perspective and for his purposes. We are to seek him in our desperation, to trust him, to honor him in all circumstances, and to trust him with the outcomes. Our daughter, she's doing well. She's got some limits, but she's doing really well. John, he's with Jesus. We miss him. He's with Jesus. Jehoshaphat, a little homework for you. I'm not going to tell you how it ends. You go read it yourself. But he didn't promise Jehoshaphat success or rescue, but Jehoshaphat sought the Lord in his despair. In everything, God is faithful. He's worthy of our worship. He calls us to seek him and his strength and to trust in his purposes. And then there's verse 12, which I didn't get to yet. Listen to this, loved ones. Take this home with you. Here's what Jehoshaphat prayed in the presence of the people of Judah. O our God, will you not execute judgment on them? For we are powerless against this great horde that is coming against us. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are on you. Yes, Lord, thank you for Jehoshaphat. Thank you for his faith. Thank you for his reminder that in desperation, we can seek his face. And when we're overwhelmed, God is enough, and we can draw near to the living God. Now, I just believe there's somebody today, this is like, oh, today I needed this. Seek the Lord. Seek the Lord. We'd love to pray with you today and get the church people praying with you. If it's not today, guys, hang on to this truth, because it's coming. And you're going to be at a point where you're like, I am powerless, but I will seek the Lord, and I will trust the Lord. Dependence in prayer in the midst of our desperation. Let me ask that we all seek the Lord together, even right now. Heavenly Father, thank you that both those words are true. You are in heaven. You are above. You have completed the work of salvation in us through your Son, Jesus Christ. And in that, we rejoice. And you are our Father. You see us. You love us. You know what is best. You know what we need. Lord, teach us to be a people who run to you with our concerns, with our fears, with our points of desperation. We thank you, Lord, that you are a strong tower and a refuge and a help. You are our provider. You're our healer. And Lord, we recognize it won't always be the way we want it to be, but help us to be a people who seek your face and trust your purposes and anchor our hope in the reality of who you are. Lord, I want to pray for anyone specifically today who just feels like it's too much. It's just too much. Lord, draw near to them and keep their eyes on you. Help us to be a people that pray, who trust you, who seek you, who receive what you have for us. And Lord, we know we can trust in you because you're good and you're sovereign. I thank you for your grace to us, Lord. I thank you for your word. Help us to walk in it now. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. Amen. Let's stand and respond.